Imagine winds, storms, the miracle of life, all from this tiny god with such tiny hands and feet.
And he's really light, too.
Yes, God did exist. He died. He was very small. Mystery solved.
Hey, what's up, everybody? We're back with another video. I've been randomly uploading lately because I've been working on a book for Broadleaf Books, and that's not going to come out till next year, so we'll talk about it next year. But in today's video, I want to talk about Christian nationalism and a bit of that history. I've been thinking about it more lately because a new trailer just came out for God's Not Dead 4, We the People. And I haven't watched the trailer yet. I've just been thinking about this and been thinking about this topic, and so I thought it would be cool to just do this video, react to the trailer live, and then give some thoughts on it and give some thoughts on Christian nationalism. Because I'm a Christian, most definitely, but I believe that Christian nationalism is actually anti-Christ. Because Christian nationalism at its core very much seems to be about dominating the world, putting the entire world under Christian hegemony, at least the entire country under Christian hegemony, but it always expands from there. And Jesus seemed to be about creating a group of people that can serve the world and love the world even with its diversity, instead of having to make everybody exactly the same and believing exactly the same and doing exactly the same. Plus, a lot of the ideology and talking points we hear from a lot of Christian nationalists in the United States today has its roots in some shady history, some shady anti-labor and anti-communist history that seem to go way too far the other direction in support of free enterprise. And we'll get to that. Let's watch this trailer, though. I'm very excited. I only watched the very first God's Not Dead. It was very cringe, but then I didn't really watch the second or third one because nobody was really around me that said, hey, let's watch this movie. Back when I watched God's Not Dead, I was still in the evangelical world, so there were people around me that wanted to watch it. And maybe that could be a bit of a word of encouragement to some of you. When you leave this world, eventually you'll find yourself not surrounded by people who want to watch these awful Christian movies. You'll be free one day, the longer you spend away from that world. All right, let's check this out. God's Not Dead, We the People.
Freedom is a fragile thing, and it's never more than one generation away from extinction. And those in world history who have known freedom and then lost it have never known it again.
Let's face it, your God, your book, they're in the way. You feel that you're making a last ditch stand for your faith, and you've chosen this as a hill that you're willing to die on.
Our whole faith started because one man chose a hill he was willing to die on.
Wait. No!
Our whole faith started because one man chose a hill he was willing to die on.
Oh man, one man chose that there was one hill he was willing to die on. Yo, I mean, so Jesus being crucified on the hill. Jesus was arrested and beaten and tortured the whole way there as he died on that hill. Oh my God. What's this guy's name? David something, who's in like every Pure Flix movie. He's delivered so many cheesy Christian movie lines in his career. I wonder where this one ranks. It's pretty bad. All right, let's keep going.
I would like to call this hearing of the House Subcommittee to order.
Right now, there's an effort on the way to mandate universal educational guidelines.
Once we decide what a child needs to know, it becomes imperative that every child know it.
Oh no! Are they going to bring critical race theory into this? I can't. It's been so hard to talk about critical race theory. Critical race theory is like something that you learn while you're getting like a higher degree in sociology at a university. It's not something that was ever trying to be taught to children. But that's how it's been framed and strawmanned by the right today, to say, hey, they're trying to teach your kids in elementary school in like second grade that white people are evil, because that's what critical race theory says, which it doesn't. And that all black people are victims, which it doesn't. It's simply just looking at history and saying, oh yeah, if we look at history and we look at our laws, we can see that throughout history, people of different races have been treated differently. That's it. That's it. And like I said, it's taught to people who are able to engage with that history in a responsible way because they've already been studying sociology and history for a while. I don't know. It could be anything, though. I mean, when I was a kid, before all this critical race theory fear-mongering, they were even talking about education and what they're teaching you and how they're going to teach you it's okay to be gay and it's going to make kids want to be gay. That was a big thing when I was a little kid. That's all weird fear-mongering. And it's all about control. Remember, as I talked about in this video, about like dominating the world? And it's not really about trying to present alternative ideas side by side. They'll say that, well, if you're going to teach evolution, then maybe you should teach creationism too. But they don't really want that. They want to get rid of the teaching of evolution and only have creationism. I mean, not as many these days. They've kind of given up that fight as they've moved on to like fighting the gay agenda, the trans agenda, and now critical race theory. But it's still the same kind of thing. They don't want to have multiple perspectives. Teach that secular perspective and the Christian perspective. It's only teach the Christian perspective. That's what, it's ridiculous. Creating educational environments where we actually could teach all perspectives, including the Christian fundamentalist perspective, is a whole different conversation. But I think these Christian fundamentalists should realize that maybe there's something up with their ideologies if, when people get in a room and learn all the perspectives, including theirs, that they don't really want to have anything to do with the Christian fundamentalist one. And that's often what happens when people learn other perspectives, then they stop being a Christian fundamentalist. So Christian fundamentalism often relies on people never hearing other perspectives, because that's how they lose people. But of course, there's other versions of Christianity that can handle the debate and is willing to evolve and change as we learn new things and include all kinds of different perspectives and have a more responsible grown-up faith that doesn't rely on a very narrow view of the world. And that's okay. That's in the Bible. The Bible is filled with alternative perspectives contradicting with one another and debating with one another, and we engage with this stuff and we continue the conversation. That's what it means to be engaged with the Christian faith. Okay, I'm ranting already. Let's just play. Okay, let's go.
Remember the visit we got from social services the other day?
I'm here to review your homeschooling environment.
Religion is
oh! I'm sorry, I didn't know I was going to pause this much, but it's just like all these tropes of like, yeah, we try to homeschool our kids, but one day they're not even going to let you teach what you want even in homeschool because Christians are persecuted. But of course, like that whole thing is just trying to get to a place where Christians could be considered a protected group so that they may have freedom to discriminate against others. That's the goal, legally. And many people who push this ideology may not realize that that's the goal, but the people that they're being taught this ideology through, that's definitely their goal. Okay, let's keep going.
Schools. They're teaching kids that they don't need God.
If your children do not show up at school.
No, okay. Oh, wait, what is she doing in this movie? Oh my God. That's the Fox News lady. That's all I really know about this lady. But no teacher has ever taught anyone that they don't need God. Okay, let's keep going.
School a week from Monday, you will be charged with contempt of court, meaning you will be incarcerated.
And they're going to jail for it?
Shannon said last night she doesn't want her parents going to jail.
This is bigger than just homeschooling. I think we should fight this. We need to.
Just want to make sure you understand what you're fighting here.
Our district teaches a revisionist version of history.
God is for us.
Yeah, they're so correct. our district does teach, all school districts do teach a revisionist view of history. And that revisionist view of history usually is this idea that these good old Europeans were escaping religious persecution and were looking for a place to practice some good old religious freedom and tolerance. And they met some Indians or indigenous people and decided, I guess we need to make room for all of us. And then some stuff happened. It doesn't really matter. And then we became the United States. And then I had teachers even say, like, that it was founded on, like, Christian principles, which isn't exactly true. But that's so weird. It already is teaching revisionist history. Trying to get people to be more honest about the violence within American history and within Christian history is trying to repair the revisionist history that's been stuffed down our throats all these centuries. Okay, let's keep going. I did not know I was going to pause this much.
Who can be against us?
Not around here. Just about everyone else.
The country is just now beginning to realize that unity means winning under our terms.
For 2,000 years, men have been trying to get rid of Christianity. What makes you think that you can accomplish what they couldn't?
They didn't have an 83% approval rating.
Hey, here it goes. Here it comes.
That's part of your plan, isn't it? Keep us all divided so we don't realize that you're really chipping away at our freedoms and liberties.
America is a country so blessed, to whom much is given, much will be required.
You see those statues and those monuments out there? They say, you work for us.
You are out of order, Mr. Bell.
A government of the people, by the people, for the people.
Yo! Oh my God. Okay. Wow. Okay. Thomas Altizer, is God dead?
God is dead.
I know one thing for sure. The God that these people are worshiping is definitely dead. Absolutely. And I believe in a God that is so much bigger than this. So much bigger than America and the people who feel the need to defend it and hold on to it so tightly, as if the billions of years of evolution was leading toward God's plan for America. At least from their perspective. It's still ridiculous, even from a creationist perspective, 6,000 years of history leading to America? Empires come and go, and so will this one. So, I had already said I've been thinking about Christian nationalism for a bit when I first saw what this movie was going to be about. We can't even really tell what it's about that much, but it's clearly about, like, patriotism of some kind, and we the people and all that, and being against big government that's trying to control the church or whatever. But it's interesting because it also makes me think there's, like, three big roots to the origin of Christian patriotism and Christian nationalism as we know it today in the United States. The first one being in the 1940s to 1950s in response to FDR's New Deal, which pretty much painted the free enterprise businessmen as the villains of the Great Depression and painted the welfare state that actually provided a bit of a social safety net through some social programs as the salvation to people's poverty. And so in response to this, these businessmen started to hire people for PR to try to get their image and reputation back on good terms. And that included getting pastors on their payroll to start preaching this alternative message that said, actually, the real Christian message should be to support free enterprise. Because FDR, on his side, also had Christians who were saying that actually creating these government programs that would actually help people get out of poverty is the Christ-like thing to do. And so in response to that, they're like, actually, the government is trying to, like, be God and taking away the freedom of business people because they're putting regulations on their business and having these pro-union laws. And actually, businessmen are the reason that we have everything in this country. So actually... The government is trying to take away our freedoms, and these businessmen want to give back our freedoms in the name of free enterprise, where the market controls all goods and services and decides the prices for it, as opposed to a welfare state where anywhere from a few to a bunch of programs are created to provide everybody with these services that are needed for survival. And yes, there were problems with the New Deal, and I feel like that was kind of a first step in a direction that wanted to create way more of a safety net for people and hopefully also crack down on all these practices that exploited the labor of so many people. And it all got cut short mostly because of the backlash of free enterprise propaganda, and that included Christians teaming up with these businessmen to preach this alternative message that says they're trying to create a government out of God, but what America is really about is freedom, and only God can give us what we need to survive, not the government. And that wasn't like a huge movement in U.S. Christianity initially until the 1950s, when the Soviet Union became this big enemy and they realized, oh, the Soviet Union, their religion is atheism. Our religion is Christianity. And we see communism trying to take over the whole world, and they might take over our country too. So in order to resist that, we need to reclaim our Christian roots. And they already had this movement that I just described bubbling up, and then that just got adopted by a huge chunk of Christianity at that point. And Dwight Eisenhower started really like pressing this message of Christian nationalism and teaming up with these businessmen and preachers that were preaching this message of less government, more God. And then thirdly, a big thing that kind of led to what we now know as Christian nationalism was in the 70s, the creation of the moral majority or the religious right that pretty much just plugged all that energy that I just described into the Republican Party and created a voting bloc of evangelicals that was manipulated through the Republican Party promising religious freedom no matter what. Just vote for whatever we say and against those evil Democrats who want to take away your religious freedom and teach your kids that you don't need God and all that stuff. So there's actually a bunch of other major events that led to what we now know as Christian nationalism, but those are three big ones that I was thinking of today before I even watched this trailer. But then I realized, like, it's all over this trailer as well, as they're talking about, like, freedom and the you government, you're supposed to serve us, not control us, and all that language has its roots in this early pro-free enterprise Christian propaganda. So no matter where you are politically, religiously, whatever, I think it's good to understand the roots of these various ideas that we're swimming in here, instead of just taking them in without questioning and just accepting them as, oh, this must be maybe what Christians have always believed. No. You can't say that about anything, really. This is what Christians have always believed. There's always some sort of event within history that a lot of beliefs within Christian ideologies had its origin in, or was a reaction to something. So if you're not a Christian, I imagine you already know it's probably good to know that history. But if you are a Christian, I think it's very good for you to know that history as well. You don't have to affirm and defend all forms of Christianity And you don't have to walk away from it completely either. There's always been this radical stream within Christianity throughout its entire history that saw major Christian institutions collaborating with the state to just dominate the world and said, actually, I don't think that's Jesus. I don't think that's Christ-like. I think perhaps Jesus would have us live a different way. And they chose to live a different way. Even if that meant resisting against Christian institutions as Christians. There's plenty of people and groups within history that we can point to that were a part of that radical stream. And I try to affirm that radical stream with the community we're building on here. And I know there's a ton of you who feel the same way. And that's exciting. You're not alone. Trust me. And you could do this. We're all in this together, okay? Thank you for watching this video, though. And like, subscribe, comment, all that fun stuff. And if you want to support me, you can check me out on patreon.com/DamonGarcia. Thank you to all my supporters who are already over there. I really appreciate the support. Always have fun making these videos. And once again, sorry for randomly uploading lately and not being as consistent as I used to be, but we're getting to the end of finishing this book, and then we'll get more on some sort of schedule. So thanks for sticking with me throughout this time. I appreciate it. All right. See you later. Bye-bye.